man emerges from his self-imposed immaturity. This sort of rhymes with an important concept of sort of German culture that has been the main sort of motto or concept in the German sort of arts management culture and North Europe as well, which is Bildung. This is sort of education, acculturation, growth. Growth is a concept that is often used in as well, development. And the word itself, culture, is of course connected with this sort of springing from the earth, developing, growing. This idea of maturation, of stop being immature and growing, resonates with that. The individual, however, is sunk in immaturity and even prefers it, and so self-cultivation is largely unsuccessful. So Kant asks next, are we living in an enlightenment phase? Is our present moment now, are we enlightened? And his answer is no. We're not. But we might be moving towards that. And yet we have a clear indication that the field is now being opened from them to work freely towards this. And the obstacles to general enlightenment or to the exit out of their self-incurred immaturity become even fewer. So we have the opportunities, and we have more opportunities right now in this day and age, in our time, 1784. There's one thing to say about this. So why is Kant talking about it? Who is he talking to? Who's he having a conversation with? He doesn't say it out loud. There's no sort of clear indication. He doesn't mention his name, but we saw his picture earlier. In the when we were talking about the development of the classical concept, Friedrich the Great, second king of Prussia, was the king there, and he was sort of an enlightened monarch, and Kant, sensing the how important these times are, because people are talking about, of course, revolution. You know, 5 years later, there's a revolution in France, and the Kant was very interested in those developments. But he's saying, he's stating in this that if you let us, the citizens, think free, we'll be more mature and we'll achieve great things together. But there are areas where this is not appropriate. The free thinking is not appropriate. And that has become one of the contested ideas that comes from this article. So, only one ruler in the world says, one ruler. So who is that? Frederick the Great. That's who he's talking to. Argue as much as you like and about whatever you like, but obey. So in certain areas of society, you you don't argue. In certain professions and some circumstances. So, what are those circumstances, do you imagine? Yes, obeying the law. I mean, you know, like traffic laws and stuff like that. Aha. Okay. So you're allowed to criticize some parts of the government, but not maybe the head of state. Definitely. There are areas such as those, but Kant is particularly thinking of war. He's thinking about the army. He's thinking about because Frederick the Great was so named because he often went to war and he was very successful in the battle. He was also a very successful musician, so he would play the flute and he would conduct the opera orchestra as well. And he's sort of the modern sort of father of the structure of armies that we have today. So he became this great figure in sort of formulating the army, having the first professional army. For his time, they were very much into sort of pillaging and robbing and stuff. But he made a sort of point out of paying for their services. One of the innovations. So here's Kant speaking, and you can see who his audience is. Men of certain age and stature. So he says, now in many affairs conducted in the interest of a community, certain mechanisms require the means of which some of its members must conduct themselves in an entirely passive manner, as though an artificial anonymity, the government may guide them toward public ends, at least prevent them from destroying such ends being victory and war. Here one certainly must not argue, instead one must obey. And he's, when describing those mechanisms, he's talking about bureaucracy, structure of government institutions, and the way that we have structured our schools. How about this structure? The orchestra comes. Is that a structure where you can argue or obey? It's sort of on the surface, at least. It seems to be a very formal and sort of strict in its organization, preventing people from behaving in a certain way. Now, if you stand up as you can, and there are multiple examples of this, for instance, at concert of chamber music, people sometimes stand up during the performance and start saying something about something that they want to come up. This has happened when, for instance, Israeli musicians are performing in Europe and people are demonstrating against Israeli policies in the occupied areas in Palestine. So you can see sort of the whole situation becomes sort of a political thing. But what happens then? The performance stops. and that's always what happens when somebody makes a noise in the audience of classical concert, the conductor will stop. Even if somebody coughs. I don't know if you've been at a performance where that has happened. It becomes very tense. Also, if somebody comes in late, and the conductor with sort of angrily look at the newcomers, this more often than not happens when a new conductor, sort of a newly hired main conductor for an orchestra comes to town, so he wants to educate his public that this won't be tolerated at our concerts. And this is also done out of respect for the rest of the audience, because they don't like the solution any more than he does. Anyway, this was an aside. Topic. Foucault, a French philosopher,
born in 1920,
dies in 1984. This was his last piece. Criticizes Kant on several points. Have you heard about Foucault, or is it? I see a nod. One of the most influential thinkers of post-modernity. Criticism of the Enlightenment project, and a sort of a critic of almost everything that Kant stands for throughout the years. So his point is that the individual is always dependent on his or her circumstances and his will to power. The will to take charge of our own circumstances over ourselves. Any form of knowledge or ideals that are presented by philosophers as sort of universal knowledge or universal ideals are also part of that struggle. And they are useful aids for those who employ them. For instance, for Kant, who uses the categories of public-private as a sort of a universal division. But in effect, Kant is using those concepts just to make a deal with the ruler. So he can get space to think for himself, and the public can think freely if there's such a thing as the private realm where the ruler rules. And the idea of a mature individual is only a metaphor. But for what end? Why does Kant put this metaphor? What are your thoughts on that? Is it something that you sort of feel is helpful? True? That our goal in life is to become mature?
That's a little bit impossible to measure, because as you were saying, everything is dependent on the circumstance.
Uh-huh.
And as human beings, you shape yourself and change yourself throughout your life, depending on your environment and
your
brain factors.
Uh-huh.
So how can you ever really know when you got there?
Yeah, this metaphor depends on an idea of life as a sort of a progress towards some end, and you travel throughout that progress, you become mature. This very much puts up on pedestal the man with great gray hair who have now become the mature people. Younger people do not have a voice. By this definition of being mature, you can say that you can put down arguments from others by saying that I'm mature enough to voice them. I mean, there's a lot of stuff hanging in there. You know, there's, like if you think about, if the goal in life is to mature yourself, you know, what comes with it? There's always some baggage. It's always something that perspective. And Foucault is critical of any system that divides knowledge and science into seemingly autonomous categories that only get legitimized through the repetition of the same question and methods and are reinforced by the accepted discourse with apparatuses. Any kind of field or a discipline, for instance, arts management, will come up with jargon, theories, methods, answers, questions, especially questions that they keep repeating to themselves, and through that process become accumulate knowledge which is nothing but a way to control circumstances, control our own destinies, control other people's destinies, control institutions, one of the innovative ways in which Foucault looks at these things is that he equals knowledge with power. So power is nothing. It is not a bad word. It's not not something that we should be afraid of. It's the way we get by in life. So we all use power. We use that power by various different means. For instance, this structure here with the seating is put up so that the power of the lecturer is underlined. See, I'm here being in control of the time, most importantly, because that's the main element that's sort of keeping you here for this particular period. I use my voice to control your attention, pitch and rhythm, and my hands as well to get your attention. But how do you use your power in a situation like this? I used to have younger students. The younger students. And some of them would sit in the back with sort of boots and like this and not engaged in the classroom at all. And I was wondering, guys, why are you doing it? I couldn't really, because I was young as well, so I couldn't really sort of ask them, well, what the hell are you doing here? Because you're paying good money. Well, at least you're giving your time to this. And this might be your opportunity to do something with your life. I was teaching management. So that's one way. So what do you signal with a hood on your head and not paying attention? I don't care.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah. So how do we use a computer?
Well,
you build a wall.
Yeah.
So I'm doing this. You're not in charge of my time, of what I'm doing. So, and you use your eyes as well. We do. So, So you flick your eyes away. If I ask a stupid question, you'll go, you really go back to your computer, to Facebook or whatever you do, and signal to me that I'm not gonna be sort of let me rephrase that you are not gonna be sort of put here on some kind of test or a quiz, or obliged to answer questions. So we use our bodies, we use our whole conduct, our clothing, everything that we do to signal to others and to take charge of our own lives and to be the masters of our being. This is very important to Foucault, by the way, so that's why we were talking about it. We'll get back to this. So Foucault is constantly searching for ways, generally, out of the tradition and the formalized thinking structures. So that's how he gets into philosophy. So he's not only philosophy, he's looking at the history of institutions with a broad category. It calls them practices of, I might have put it up. So, discipline, again, what we mentioned at the beginning, discipline is a mechanism of power which regulates the behavior of individuals in the social body. This is done by regulating the organization of space, for instance, in classrooms and in concert rooms, space of time, timetables, etc., and people's activity and behavior, drills, posture, movement, anything that you're made to do. So earlier on, I signaled that you might stand up and walk about for 10 minutes, and then you're required to return to your seat. And we do this without thinking much about it. But it's, you know, in a way, it's absurd. I mean, we're all grown-up people. Why should I be telling you what to do? Foucault emphasizes that power is not discipline. Rather, discipline is simply one way in which power can be exercised. So he also uses the term disciplinary society, discussing its history and the origins of disciplinary institutions such as prison, hospital, asylums, schools, and army barracks, and cultural institutions. He also specified, when he speaks of a disciplinary society, it doesn't mean a disciplined society. One of his main, most influential idea is the panoptical. He often gets referred to. Anybody heard about that? This is one of my ways to establish my power of authority. Understand? So when I ask you something, and you all sort of shake your head, so whatever, or I mention a name or something, I sort of lift myself up a little bit, sort of build up my authority in the classroom. And I do. Yeah. So you understand how these processes work. Anyway, he talks about a building that Jeremy Bentham, one of the Enlightenment thinkers, writes this in 1791. He talks about prison, where he describes an ideal prison where
sorry, I remembered it now.
Yeah, good. So the building is like a circle.
Yeah.
And the cells are all here in the circles, but these are multi-layered. So they're like five stories. like this. And the all the inmates, the prisoners, are in their cells, of course, but you can see through them. So there are no walls. So there's no dark corner in those cells. But there's no other sort of restrictions on them. But you know, like they have to stay in themselves, so in those cells. And there's in the middle of the circle is a tower where the inmates can be watched all day long. But the tower is built in that way, so you can't see in it. You don't know if there's anybody in the tower. You don't know if anybody's watching you. Maybe they're watching somebody else. So you can do whatever you need to do. But you don't know. So in time, you imagine that there is always somebody watching all the time. And the beauty of the structure for Jeremy Bentham is that then nobody has to be in the tower. Because all the inmates just believe there's somebody in the tower. And this is the way Foucault takes this idea as one of Enlightenment's best ideas. And said, well, okay, we in fact have built a society on those premises where we all think we're being watched all the time. And we in effect, become our own prison guards. This, of course, being the central moral of George Orwell's 1984, best-selling book these days. I went to the bookstore, Barnes & Noble's. There's a huge bookstore in a parking lot, not meant to be sort of accessed by foot
or any other means than driving.
So, but I went there, and it's a massive, it's like a warehouse full of books. And there are aisles and aisles of books, and I wasn't sure what I was going to buy there, but and then I suddenly remember that there was one book that I hadn't read, and I always thought I had read it, but I should pick it up. This was 2 weeks ago. And so I got in, like, and I had to look around. It wasn't like being displayed in the front or anywhere. And there were like 5 people in the store. It's a massive store. So I go and finally find one corner in the aisles, like, in the back. Did I mention how big the So while I'm there, you know, like finding my book, another woman comes and takes exactly the same book, and we start talking, and she's angry about the situation in America or something. I mean, like, and while we're there, a third person comes and takes a copy of that same book. I mean, it's an old fictional book, and this being, of course, Orwell's 1984. And this was the and it was the it was from the 60s. And so it has had a great comeback. Any idea why? It is because of developments in society. Reading it, it's a fantastic book, but it's not exactly descriptive of what's happening with Donald Trump particularly, but this is the kind of society we're building slowly, but it so happens to be governed by Donald Trump right now. Okay, so this is a lot of. I mean, I could go on about Foucault's, Michel Foucault's critique of Kant's position, but critique is one of the one word that Foucault sort of really takes out of the text. That, well, we shouldn't be looking particularly at the categories. Those are just means that Kant uses for his time in his conversation with the ruler, and they don't hold. I mean, there's nobody who's going to tell you in which category you're in right now. There are all kinds of gray areas, and we just make those things up as we go along. But there is a particular concept where he that he focuses on, which is the critique. He says that is the mission of the Enlightenment. That is what we should be doing. Enlightenment is the age of critique. Look at, as Kant does, at your own time, at the historic times that you live in, and look and see if those times, your here and now, is enlightened in which way it's not, and which way it is. And he says, this is what Kant does for the first time in the West's intellectual history. He's looking critically at the moment in which he lives. And this might help us understand what modernity does. He looks particularly to Foucault, to Georges Baudelaire, a French poet who advocates modernity and art. I'm not getting into complicated guys, but his method being hero resizing, lifting up the present moment as the moment. So rather than looking back at some particular time or the times that we might be moving towards, it's the here and now that we should be looking. And modernity is the attitude that makes it possible to grasp the heroic aspects of the present moment. And he takes a few examples. I'm not getting into that, but he takes Baudelaire. Anybody that's, well, I'll stop. The French poet, ephemeral. Yeah. I pronounce this differently in my own language. The fleeting, the contingent, the things that are happening right now that are not constant, will not be here tomorrow. Something that will disappear. And grasping that. And Foucault says that is the attitude of modernity. That is our time. That is what Kant does. That is what those times brought to us. We should not be taking their categories, the systems and structures and the way they divide knowledge into different disciplines, but we should take that attitude. And that project, finding the heroic in the moment, we do through making our own life into an aesthetical project, work of art. We use bodies, behavior, feelings, passion, existence are made into a work of art that explores modernity, the here and now. And this becomes very important for Foucault, that to explain how we can shape ourselves. We are not doomed to take certain categories. He himself, being homosexual, had difficulties because of the categorization of men and women, or the heteronormative
system, very clearly.
He used drugs to escape. He used sadomasochistic sex. He used a lot of stuff to break out of the categories that he was given. And tries to invent himself to break free. Not to mature, but to be constantly breaking free out of the moment. Okay. It compels, the modernity compels the man to face the task of producing yourself. So we have techniques of the self and the arts of existence, as he calls them, those reflective and voluntary practices by which men not only set themselves rules for conduct, but seek to transform themselves, to change themselves in a singular being, and to make of their life into an oeuvre, work that carries certain aesthetic values and meets certain stylistic criteria. So he looks towards art because he sees that as the most freest ways in which we can think. But it's not art in the common sense or conventional meaning. It's rather sort of a concept of aesthetically challenging your restrictions. Yes?
Sorry.
Yes? Okay. Do I press chat? Or what do I do? Okay. Yes, you're online. We have a caller. Nope. And that again. What do I do now? Call a psychic? Can you? I'm afraid if I test anything that it will. Everyone will disappear.
Just says the audio is inconsistent. So maybe like the speaker is moving too far away from microphone at times.
I see.
Yep.
We'll try to take notice of that for the rest of the session. Okay, so questions to ask, what do I do, what do I know, the way I answer questions, the way I dress, the way I conduct myself, these are the areas that Foucault wants us to focus on in our exploration of ourself, of our identity, the identity that we should be producing ourselves and not let anybody else give it to us. By birth or nationality or by color or sexual preferences or any of that. You are allowed to and you are encouraged to produce yourself. Okay, class assignment. Last slide. An arts institution, what do you, that you know, does it empower people to think critically? How could the institution inspire people to think for themselves if we take the cue from Kant? Given the power to change, what do you think is necessary and what does this question make sense? Yeah, if there's a, yeah, okay, so what, no. What do you think is necessary?
Oh,
And what would you change?
That was my thinking when I was writing this. I promise. I was thinking of it. It might have been late. I might have been in Vegas. I don't know. Okay, I'm not going to divide you into groups. We can do this quickly, but you need to be alive for 5 minutes. So, what is the institution? Any? Not always the same people. Mind you, the quicker we get through this, the quicker we get out.
Denver Museum of Art.
Denver Museum of Art. Does it empower people to think critically? Yes? In what way? Okay. 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 So they provide you with images, paintings, and other stuff. I think I've been there. Yeah. Maybe feel tired. It was a lot of floors. Remember.
I mean, I don't know if that really is empowering people to think critically.
Okay.
Not imposing thoughts upon them.
Okay.
They should do what they want or not.
Okay, so we're taking the standard arts museum. You don't have to have been in Denver Museum of Art to think about these things. Okay, so we got a normal, big arts museum. More than art. No, it's all kinds. It's even, there's Indian. Yes. I like the Americana, the Men on Horses section. That was interesting. Anyway, so how could the institution inspire people to think for themselves, taking any art museum?
Maybe in some way ask those who enter open-ended questions.
Uh-huh.
So that people have that question in their mind and then they can use the artwork and then contemplate that question.
Yes.
In their own conclusion.
Uh-huh. Have you experienced any tactics on behalf of a art museum that would sort of encourage you to contemplate, be critical, voice your opinion. Anybody? Often, I remember from London, Tate Modern would often ask people to write on notes, put on walls if there was something controversial going on, something was being displayed that. So that people were debating, or there was competition going on as well. They had those competitions as well. So they were trying to engage people in a conversation through that. Any other ways?
Maybe one moment did with those particular.
Yes.
That's kind of a way to start a conversation.
Yes.
While we're specifically taking a very political situation.
Yes.
Now come and see what you think.
Uh-huh. And it asks us to take a stand, and it tells us that this particular policy isn't just at the borders or at the airport, it's in the museum as well. That's what they say. It's here, it's now, it's with us. So you're like, even if you disagree with that, they are saying it is. So you're gonna have to take a stand, or at least sort of think about it, if you like it, or if you agree with them, or if you want to go even further.
say, well, you know, why are we even looking at art when we should be fighting for freedom? These are the kind of questions some people ask. Okay, so given the power to change, what do you think is necessary to do, and what would you change?
If we're dealing with a setup, then it's from, you know, the length of age, but it's really kind of, it is, you know, reinforcing that power dynamic that, if it's really enforcing that, then maybe we need to instead change how we do that. So instead of you walk into an art museum and you're expected to be quiet, what if you walked into an art museum and you were expected to start a conversation, you were expected to start discussing, or what if you were even expected to just make your own art and add that to the collection, or in some way, you know, switch up how you've been.
I think this just makes me think, like, that we're not constrained to the format that we might assume is right. Way that we present our whatever we have to the community,
yep.
That we can do it in a way that
for what. So we could use those institutions better. So we are not constrained in the way we maybe think we are.
I'm sort of thinking of what you said earlier in the beginning about maybe one person like starting to behave differently, and then maybe others will start behave differently. I mean, there's lots of opportunities within the confines of the art museum to behave in a different way. Some of them might be too noisy or would get in the way of us enjoying the art. But some might be interesting to explore. And nothing must necessarily is going to happen. Nobody's going to die. I mean, it's just arts management. Okay. That's it for the day. I'd like to see you again in a week.
Yeah.
Monday.
Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you all very much for coming.
Thank you.
I know it's not obligatory, but almost not. I guess some complex thing system. Yeah. I'm joking. Of course I get it.
Okay. You have this?
Yeah.
I love my work. They're like everything's exploding everywhere, and I don't even understand why.
There's somebody to answer the question.
Okay. Yeah. Those and tools, yes. Also record the tools, yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, you really need a better system for the online people. There are fantastic both equipment and software to do this.
Yeah.
It's just not being used here.